Why do I smile so much? If you look at this image before you, you see your regular resting face, which is the face that most people assume that I should have in the work and the life that I do. But it actually takes effort to smile, and I like to put that effort into smiling. It actually takes more muscles on your face to smile. So when someone's smiling at you, they're actually doing work and putting in the effort. But I smile, even though people ask me all the time, why do I do it? Not because I'm the village idiot or some fool that just likes to walk around grinning at everyone. I smile as an act of self-love. I smile as an act of resistance. Resistance to those forces that would seek to oppress me and those around me and those that are seeking equality in our nation and in our world. I also smile for gratitude. Gratitude. I am grateful for the struggle that I have endured that has made me who I am and given me the perspective that I have to be able to help others to live their best life. Black joy, as this image says to you, is black resistance. And black resistance to struggle engenders progress. And progress is something to smile about. Now, Frederick Douglass once said that there is no progress without struggle. And that means that as soon as we stop struggling, we stop growing. We atrophy. We become static. So we need struggle to be able to move forward and to be our best selves. When I was younger, growing up at 3243 West Taylor Street in Phoenix, Arizona, in one of the most poor areas of the Valley of the Sun, I was teased because I had two moms, one black, one white, one pansexual, one lesbian, in a predominantly minority area, and I attended a Catholic school, a very conservative one. My father wasn't around, and this circumstance was a source of humor for many of the young people around me because they didn't know any better, and kids can be cruel. But I was teased because of the sexual orientation of my family, because I was poor where I lived, because of the color of my skin. And even though that was difficult at the time, it made me much stronger as an individual later on. I also struggled with homelessness because when my mother came out to my grandmother, and I miss her dearly, and she was a wonderful woman, but she was born in 1914. She was a Victorian woman, and she did not like or approve of my mother's lifestyle. And as such, she kicked us out of the house. And our home became my mom's 1979 Cutlass Supreme, Oldsmobile Cutlass Supreme. And in that car, I lived. The back seat was my bedroom. The front driver's seat was my mom's bedroom. And the passenger seat was our kitchen and our dining room and our family room and everything else that we needed to do outside our living quarters. That struggle taught me something about homelessness and the value of life and having a roof over your head and the fact that homelessness can happen to anyone. That struggle made me stronger. I also struggled in learning how to survive amidst being ridiculed and disrespected. I also struggled and have gratitude for struggle for the perspective that all of this gave me. Understanding that race, class, gender, sexual orientation, and one's economic status should not be a determinant for their worth or their future success. Now, when I went to college, at Arizona State University, I encountered a very homogenous circumstance. People didn't come from a family like me where you had gays and lesbians and pansexuals and black folks and Jehovah's Witness and Muslims and Christians and all variety of Christians. And my grandmother was a housekeeper who worked for Jewish families. So I was one of the few kids on my street who ate matzo ball soup and danced to tarantella and ate so-called soul food. When I got to Arizona State University, however, at that particular time, the number of people of color was very small. So as a consequence, at a place where we were supposed to be focusing on universalities, I wanted to make sure with other people that the university actually practiced the root of university, which is universal, including everybody in that struggle. I understood and came to know that the foundation of knowledge is history. The foundation of knowledge is history. No matter what you study, architecture, law, environmental science, it has a history. And so do humans. And I wanted to make sure through that study that people understand who we all are to improve our communications and our relationships. It led to me working with a group of people that eventually took over the student union to demand these changes at the university. I understood that resistance was necessary to bring about inclusion. So I went on to graduate school and earned a PhD and learned a lot in the process, even more about who we are as a people and why struggle is so important to move forward. I became Professor Whitaker after I earned my PhD, and I came back to my alma mater, Arizona State University, and soon I became the golden boy. I was sort of a chocolate-covered unicorn at Arizona State University, indeed, Arizona. There aren't that many African-American men in the state with a PhD in history to focus on race, class, and gender, African-American history, and civil rights. And so I was asked to speak all over the place, and I enjoyed that because I wanted to give back to my community. I became that person among a few others that people went to for perspective and for knowledge about how to solve the problems that we have based upon our mistakes in the past. That did not endear me to a lot of people at my former institution because they saw me as being something other than an academic, way out into the community too much. But I loved it. And for a while, I thought, this is a Superman type of situation that I'm in. I'm donning the cape and going out and helping my community. And I spent a lot of time doing that. And in the process, I became quite sloppy in my day job, in my historical work. And I made some mistakes. I made some mistakes, particularly with citation in one of the books that I wrote. And those folks that had seen me be active at ASU long before I became Professor Whitaker, and those folks who thought that I was too active in the community, and quite frankly, those folks who thought that I was too dark, too verbose, and too committed to social justice to be a professor, used that opportunity to try to diminish me, to undermine me, to cast me as some nefarious figure, and to undermine my ability to be able to earn a life, take care of my family, and help my community. But I was humbled, because no one took that worse than I did, because I wanted to be able to be there to help my community. I was targeted. When this happened, this opened the door for folks all over the country and all over our state to do all sorts of things to threaten me and to attack me for what I was doing. I had a noose put out of my outside of my office door. I had neo-Nazis climbing over my back wall. I had death threats and letters sent to my house. People threatened to do horrible things to my family. But this is what happens when you dedicate yourself to social justice. This is what happens when you're a person of color or a woman or a marginalized person. Your margin for error is zero. And this is what I impart to my students now. They want you to be silent and shamed when you do this type of work. And there are times, particularly during this era, that I didn't feel like smiling. Now what? Now that I'm so down, now that I'm not able to do what I wanted to do because of all the vitriol around me. I'll read you something. It's a quote from Walter Anderson. And it simply says, "Bad things do happen. How I respond to them defines my character and the quality of my life. I can choose to sit in perpetual sadness, immobilized by the gravity of my loss, or I can choose to rise from the pain and treasure the most precious gift I have, life itself." And so I returned to my roots and I called up a picture of the church that my great-great-grandmother founded in Nacogdoches, Texas, or helped found and attend. And I thought to myself, the most important thing that I have in my life is my family and the work to which I have placed my hands. Social justice work. Problems are going to happen, but it's not about me. You have to rise above it, and you have to be able to smile in the process to give hope to others. So when people say, "Where did you go a few years ago, Doc?" I say, "I've never left." "Am I back?" "No. I never left because I maintained my self-love. I resisted those forces that sought to oppress me, and I have gratitude for the struggle, even those who maligned and attacked me. And that has made me the person that I am today." So in conclusion, I would say, in battle, Darling English writes, the enemy strives to wear down the opposition, continues the attacks, are a strategy to keep advocates off balance. Constantly being on guard and consistently in a state of high alert is stressful. That stressful makes us want to stop doing what we do. And when we stop doing what we do, we allow those dark forces to win. So I smile because I am joyful about who I am. I smile because the work to which I placed my hands is righteous work, and I smile because I know, despite the opposition, in the end, the good guys win. Thank you.